the ball game. Now it's going to be Larry French. French is the pitcher coming in. French at least is leaving the dugout and coming in to pitch as far as we know. Gabby is calling on Larry French to relieve Dizzy Dean here with a score 6-2-3 in favor of the New York Yankees. Score of 6-3 in favor of the Yanks on a single and a home run here in this first half of the ninth inning. The single was by Henrich out to right field, DiMaggio hitting a left field home run right over the left field wall out toward that yellow brick building just beyond the left field flagpole in the wall. It went all the way over the wall on the fly and down into the yard in front of that building over there, which at the present time are perched several spectators on top of the building and also in the windows. Larry French going into the pitch. Dizzy Dean is being given a great hand as he comes out of that ball game. Crowd all standing up and cheering for him. He's given a swell exhibition of pitching. Two more hits in this inning are 7-all off Dean in the ball game, and 6 runs off Dean. The score being 6-3. French is now going into pitch. He's in there warming up. Throwing a few warm-up pitches into Gabby Hartnett. He should be plenty warmed up. He's been warming up off and on since that first inning. Been down there in the bullpen with Jack Russell as a relief hitter, and the two of them have been warming up for a long time, and now the first man to come up is going to be Gehrig facing Larry French. Two runs across, nobody on the bases, nobody out. The first half of the ninth inning, and the score 6-3 in favor of the New York Yankees over the Cubs. Gehrig in the batter's box. Larry French is ready. There's the windup, and here's the pitch. A slow curve, a little bit wide for ball one. Ball one to Lou Gehrig. Yankees won yesterday's game 3-1. They're winning this one 6-3 today in the first half of the ninth. There's the windup, and here's the pitch. And a slow curve again breaks over the outside corner this time, waist high for a cold strike, making the count 1-1. Ball one and strike one to Lou Gehrig, the first baseman of the New York Yankees. Gehrig up, nobody on the bases, nobody out. First half of the ninth with two runs across. Here's the pitch, a ball inside and high, very fast one. Ball two, making the count 2-1. Ball two and strike one, the count. Already there's the windup by Larry French, the pitch. A swing and a miss by Gehrig for strike two, making the count 2-2. It was again that slow curve ball going away from a left-hand hitter, and he swung and missed it for strike two, making the count 2-2 to Lou Gehrig. Ball two and strike to the count. French getting a sign from Gabby, starts his windup. Here's the pitch, another slow curve. This time it's too low for ball three, making the count 3-2. Ball three and strike two to Gehrig. Nobody out in the first half of the ninth, and two runs across. Here's the pitch, and a swing and a miss. He strikes him out. Gehrig goes down swinging. Larry French strikes him up. Well, the first strikeout for French. The Yankees putting this game, at least assuming a little bit, on ice here in the first half of the ninth with two extra runs. They were already leading 4-3. Now they're leading 6-3. There's the windup by Dean. Here's the pitch. It comes up by Dean. Here's the pitch. It comes in to Bill Dickey on the inside around his knees for a ball. Ball one. Ball on the count. Dizzy getting a sign. There's the windup, and here's the, or rather, French getting a sign. He pitches the ball in, and it's a foul back into the screen and back of the plate for strike one, making the count 1-1 to Bill Dickey. Ball one and strike one, the count. The score 6-3 in favor of the Yankees over the Cubs. Bill Dickey standing up there getting a sign. Here's the pitch, and it's a ball low on the outside for ball two, making the count 2-1. Larry French steps off the pitching rubber for a moment, goes back toward the rosin bag, but does not use it, rubs the ball up. Stands up there toying the rubber now, getting a sign from Gabby, back of the plate. Larry's all set, there's the windup on the pitch, the ball is hit down to Ripper Collins. Collins fields the ball, beats him over to the bag, and Dickey is out. So Collins unassisted for the second out of the inning. That's two away, and it brings Selkirk up to the plate. Twinkle toes, George Selkirk, the left fielder, is coming up. He steps in the batter's box. With the score 6-3 in favor of the Yankee Ball Club over the Cubs in the second game of the 1938 World Series. Gabby crouching down and back of the plate, giving the sign to Larry French. Larry gets his sign, starts his windup, and here's the pitch, a fast one on the inside, almost hits him in the shoulder. He ducks away from it, it goes for ball one. Ball on the count. Selkirk the batter, two out, nobody on, and two runs across in the first half of the ninth inning. Selkirk stepped out of the batter's box, now he's back in again, taps his bat on the plate. Larry French walks up on the pitching rubber. He's taking a little bit more time between pitches than did Dean, his predecessor. Here's the pitch, and it's a ball. Low on the inside for ball two. Ball to the count. There are two outs. Already there's the windup, and here's the next one. Selkirk gets a strike, a fastball over the inside corner of the plate, waist high for strike one, making the count 2-1. 2-1 the count. Already there's the windup by Larry French. The pitch, a ball on the inside for ball three, making the count 3-1. Ball three and strike one, the count. There are two outs. Selkirk is the batter. There are two runs across. French getting a sign. Hartnett crouched down in back of the plate. Already there's the windup. Here's the pitch. A fast one on the inside. Almost hit him in the head. It goes for ball four, and he goes down to first base on a walk. Larry French has now struck out one man and walked one man. Belcock seemed to pull a little muscle in his side. He's holding his side a little bit as he walks down to first base when he tried to get out of the way of that fast ball, which was coming in his head as it came in there. It was not an intentional bean ball. It was just one of those wild throws. Ball four, he's down at first base after walking down there very slowly, still stretching, trying to get that kink out of his left side. I believe they're calling for the trainer to come out and possibly a man to run for him. Belcock stretching and flexing his muscles, goes back. The first base cushion, he's all right now. So it's one man on, two up, two runs across. Selkirk was hit by a pitch ball. It wasn't ball four. Scored as a hit by a pitch ball officially. Here's the pitch. It comes in to Gordon, and he swings and misses for a strike, strike one. Although it didn't look up here as if he'd been hit by a pitch ball, that's the official scorer has thus scored it anyway. Here's the pitch now again, and it's a strike over the outside corner to Gordon for strike two. Fastball pitched in their waist pack. Strike to the count of Gordon, the man on first base, two down and two runs across. That man hit by a pitch ball. There's a stretch to look toward first base by Larry French. Here's the next pitch to Gordon. Gordon swings and strikes out. Two strikeouts for Larry French in the inning. French pitching one inning, striking out two men, hitting one man with a pitch ball and putting him on first base. The result of the first half of the ninth inning, two runs, two hits. There were no errors, and one man was left on the bases. So my totals, as far as the Yankees are concerned, run as follows: six runs, seven hits, two errors, and two men left on the bases. We're going into the last half of the ninth inning. The score standing at 6-3 in favor of the New York Yankees, and it's the Cubs' last chance, the National League entry's last chance in this second game of the World Series to come up. Now officially, he was walked. Selkirk was walked as we originally gave you. He wrenched his back in twisting away from an inside fast ball, as I told you, and ducked away from it. It was coming in right at his head, so it's now officially given as a walk and not hit by a pitch ball. So we're going into the last half of the ninth inning. And the batter coming up there is Gabby Hartnett, a 333 hitter in yesterday's game, a fellow who's been up twice in this game today, or three times in this game today, and fight out each time. He's hit the ball hard, but right to the fielders, twice to DiMaggio, once way out there almost at the center field wall. So Hartnett is ready to step in the batter's box. Jake Powell is playing out in left field in place of Selkirk. Powell in left field. Selkirk has been taken out of the game, and Powell has been inserted in left field. Put him in your lineup in place of Selkirk. Gabby Hartnett up there at the plate. Ball has been thrown around the infield. Murphy has warmed up. He's now ready to pitch to Gabby. Three runs needed to tie up for the Cubs. And four to win. The score of the ball game, 6-3 in favor of the Yankees. Gabby swings the bat a couple of times. Murphy's ready. There's the windup and the pitch. A strike over the inside corner, waist high. Strike one, the count to Gabby Hartnett. The last half of the ninth inning of the second game of the World Series. There's the windup, and here's the next one. Hartnett swings and misses for strike two. Strike two, the count to Gabby. Murphy getting a sign. Has it. Starts his windup very slowly. Here's the next pitch to Gabby Hartnett. Gabby gets a ball. Wide, ball one. Making the count one and two. Ball one and strike two, the count. Gabby stands up there swinging that bat. Johnny Murphy looks down at Bill Dickey, gets his sign, winds up. Here's the pitch. The ball is hit out the right field. It's a fly ball, an easy out to Tommy Henrich in right field for the first out in the last half of the ninth inning. So twice, Gabby Hartnett has gone out on high fly balls to right field and twice to center field. Andrews and Hadley are both warming up down there in the bullpen for the New York Yankees in case they're needed. Johnny Murphy, however, is doing a pretty good job for the Yankees out there on the mound. He gets his sign. He's ready to pitch now to Collins. And Collins, hitting left-handed against him, sends a grounder down on the ground to the second baseman, Gordon. Gordon over to Gehrig. Gordon fumbled momentarily, but recovered in time to pick up the ball and get it over to first base for the second out. That's two away in the last half of the ninth inning. And the batter coming up there now is Billy Jurgis. Billy Jurgis stepping in the batter's box. Jurgis steps in there, taps his bat on the plate. Looks out at Murphy. Got the Billy Jurgis to keep the Cubs in the ball game by getting a base hit here if they expect to stay in the second game. However, the Yankees putting the game on ice in the first half of the ninth, went into the lead 6-3. Here's the pitch, and Jurgis gets a fast one a little bit low on the outside for ball one. Ball one, the Cubs. Jurgis swings the bat a couple of times of timing while Murphy is getting a sign. Then he reaches over and pitches the ball in. It's a high foul in back of the plate and off to the right. going into the right field section of the stands, way back in the boxes. Ball one and strike one the count. One and one the count. Yankees leading 6-3, the second game of the 1938 World Series. Here's the pitch, a ball high and on the outside for ball two. Making the count 2-1 to Bill Jurgis. Ball two and strike one the count. Bill stands up there, swings his bat once or twice. Johnny Murphy is ready. Here's the windup of the pitch, and it's a ball inside and high for ball three. Making the count 3-1. All three and strike one the count. Part of the 44,000 some odd fans are ready to leave the ballpark and is starting out. But as we've said so many times before, no ball game is over till that last man is out. 3-1 the count. Here's the pitch, and it's high for a ball. Ball four, and Jurgis goes down to first base on a walk. Jurgis didn't think he had ball four. He hesitated momentarily and started to get ready for the next pitch, but it was ball four, and Jurgis goes to first base. And some of the fans had to holler to him that it was time to go down to first base. Ball four, somebody hollered from the stands, and so Jurgis back down for first, and there he is. Billy Herman is coming in to tell the umpire Colson back of the plate of a pinch batter who is coming up here in the last half of the ninth inning for the pitcher, Larry French. That'll be Phil Cavaretta. Cavaretta coming up. Cavaretta, I believe, batted 500 in yesterday's game.
Attention, please.
Cavaretta batted 500 in the first game of the World Series. He's coming up now as a pinch batter against Johnny Murphy. He's batting for French.
Cavaretta ready to step in the batter's box. Jurgis down on first base. Two down. We're in the last half of the ninth inning. Murphy is ready. There's the stretch. Here's the first pitch now to Cavaretta, and it's the ball. High on the outside for ball one. Two bars still warming up down there for the Yankees. From Padley and Harvey Andrews. Here's the pitch. A strike over the inside corner, a fastball. Murphy firing it right down the groove over the inside corner for a strike. Ball one and strike on the count. 1-1. A man on first base and Bill Jurgis. And Phil Cavaretta the batter. Here's the pitch. He starts to swing but holds back. He gets the ball. High on the outside for ball two. Making the count 2-1. Ball two and strike one to Phil Cavaretta. A pinch batter in the last half of the ninth inning with two down and a man on first. Here's the pitch. The ball is hit on the ground. It's down and out to the Gordon, Flash Gordon's glove for a base hit, I believe. It'll be a single out the right field. Gordon went over, covering a lot of territory, and it goes as a hit. They just got a piece of that ball on the edge of his glove, but it goes as a hit going out the right field, and it gives the thousands of Cubs fans out here at the park some more hope. Two runners around the base. Jed is down on second base, and Cavaretta is down on first. Batter coming up there now is Stanley Hagg, who's had two hits for four trips, batting 500 for the day today after batting 750 in yesterday's game. Hagg stepping in the batter's box. Murphy gets ready, gets the sign from Bill Dickey. And here's the first pitch to Hagg, and it's a ball. Low on the inside to ball one. Ball on the count to Stanley Hagg. Two runners on the bases. The score is 6-3. There's a stretch to look towards second base by Johnny Murphy. Here's the pitch. Stanley Hack gets a strike. It came in at the knees and over the heart of the plate, a fastball. Making the count 1-1. Ball one and strike one to Stanley Hack with two runners on the bases. Jurgis walked, Cavaretta single to right. After two, we're down in the last half of the ninth. Here's the pitch. The ball is hit for a smash down to Crossetti. He takes a line drive right at the ground, and he is out. Hack gets a line drive smash to Crossetti, the shortstop, and he is out for the third out, and the ball game is over, and the Yankees win the second game of the 1938 World Series by a score of 6-3. The last half of the ninth inning showed no runs, one hit, no errors, and there were two men left on the bases. Totals for the time of the game was 1 hour and 53 minutes, and the totals on the game for New York, 6 runs, 7 hits, 2 errors. For Chicago, 3 runs, 11 hits, no errors. There were two men left on the bases for the New York Yankees, and there were seven men left on the bases by the Cubs. Those are the totals on the game officially as they've come to us on our speaker. John Harrington speaking to you, and now here again is Pat Tunney.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? All ready to go on and tell you what happened in the ball game and speak about some of the ball players who seem to be the heroes. Cassetti, of course, getting his home run, which put them ahead and actually drove in what was the winning run. 42,108 people actually attended the ball game. $203,000 is what was just $205,437, the official receipt. $205,437. 15% for the commissioner, minus that, $30,813. $1,355. That's what was minus for the commissioner. Well, as long as these things are coming over the loudspeaker, I might just as well go ahead and talk. Of course, today, we must say again that the hero of the series this afternoon was again this boy, Crosetti, who played a beautiful game. He started two double plays that pulled the Yankees out of bad spots and pulled Gomez out of bad spots. And then we have Crosetti, who hit a home run and actually drove in the winning run himself. He'd been aiming at that left field wall all afternoon. He hit a hard, well-hit ball up into the stands out near the 368-foot mark. The other man who showed Yankee power for the first time this afternoon was DiMaggio. He had no hits yesterday. He got a single in the second inning and came in and scored on that play on which Gordon hit a slow ball and Jurgis and Hack both charged it. It rolled between them and they hit each other and knocked each other down. That's how they got two of their runs. Then, of course, DiMaggio got a home run of the man aboard in the ninth inning. Dizzy Dean went out there with an arm that hurt him like a toothache, and you've got to give him credit for being a great soldier going up against the power attack of the Yankees. It took them eight innings to finally really get to him. And that was in the eighth and the ninth when they really got him down. The Yankees won by a score of 6-3 in a ball game that was hard fought and well played all the way through. Some sparkling infield plays, some sparkling outfield work. Crosetti, as I told you, tried very hard to get that ball out in left field, and three times Reynolds robbed him of hits by catches out in the left field corner. But that one run that he got, that one terrific wallop over the fence, made him, of course, the hero for the Yankees. However, we mustn't forget that Crosetti played a bang-up ball game himself, and on that last ball that was played and was hit down there just a moment ago by Stan Hack, Crosetti came in fast as if to play an ordinary ground ball, but he got the ball in his glove just about 3 inches above the ground while he was on the dead run. He hung on to that ball, stumbled, and hung on and would not let go. He did a fine piece of work all afternoon. Of course, if the Cubs had won, there would have been someone be sure to write or talk about Rolf being the GOAT on account of two errors. But the Cubs did not win, so that's all forgotten. And most of the play now will go to DiMaggio and Crosetti, particularly Crosetti, who drove in those winning runs. Dean pitched a great game, and you can see that when you stop and figure that during the time he was in, for eight innings and two men pitched two in the ninth, he still had only allowed seven hits, but two of those were home runs, each of the man aboard. He allowed two hits in the second, he allowed one hit in the fourth, and then he allowed two in the eighth, and finally they got to him for a hit in the ninth. A couple of hits, a single and a home run. So Dean tried very hard. Lefty Gomez now has a record, having won this ball game, the only man who ever won six straight World Series games. There were two other men who had won six World Series games, but in among those six, we find that there were two of them that went, one of them apiece, that went for losses. Two men won World Series games, and of course, the pitchers were Bender and Hoyt. They each have six to the record, but each one was charged with at least one defeat, whereas Gomez has just exactly six straight wins and no losses. A great ball game all the way through. The Yankees and the Cubs are going to play their next game at the Yankee Stadium down in New York. That, of course, is the stadium that most people speak of as the trick stadium in which the Yankees can take shots at certain parts of the field for those home runs. But there was nothing tricky about the home runs they got this afternoon. They were both well-hit balls. When they get down there, as far as Yankee Stadium being built as a trick stadium for home runs, the Cubs have exactly the same chance to hit the ball in those same spots. They haven't been aiming at them so long, but they still have that same chance. So when anybody tells you a ball field is built for a certain team, remember that the other team that goes into the play has exactly the same advantage and the same disadvantages that the home team does. They may not be quite so accustomed to certain little things, but at the same time, it doesn't make an awful lot of difference, particularly when it's a series like this, where you've got to win four out of seven. The series isn't over by a long shot, but two of the boys have gone up there for the Cubs, and two of the boys have gone down. This is a well-played, a hard-hitting game this afternoon with the kind of thrills you like to see at a World Series. We've had a great time broadcasting for you this afternoon, Johnny Harrington and myself. We just want to tell you now that this broadcast of the World Series game between the Chicago Cubs and the New York Yankees has come to you from Wrigley Field, the home of the Cubs in Chicago. We return you to our studios.
This is the WBBM Air Theater, Wrigley Building, Chicago.